නෑ යාට අද මේ බෑන් ප්‍රක්ටිස් තියනවා මේ මම රෙකෝඩ් කරප එක පෙන්න්න.
එතකොට කාටවත් යන්න බැරියේද?
ඒ අනික් අය මොකද මේ විදත්ගි ස්කෝලේ අද තියෙනවා මේ කම්පිටිෂන් එක.
දැන්නම් මිනිත්තු තව දෙකයි තියෙන්නේ.
ඔව් හැබැයි මම දැක්කා මේ චන්දර ලින්ක් එක අනික් කට්ටියට යවලා තිබුණා දැක්කා.
මං හිතුවා මේ මේ කතා පටන් ගත්ත හින්දා මේ මේ නෝබල් එයිට් ෆෝල් පෑත් එකෙන් පස්සෙත් හැම ඉරිදටම අඩු ගානේ මිනිත්තු 15ක් 20ක්වත් ළමයින්ට පොඩි ධර්ම දේශනාවක් කරන්න කියලා ඉංග්‍රීසියෙන්. ඉතින් ඒකට දෙතුන් දෙනෙක් ආවත් මට කමක් නැහැ, කවුරු හරි රෙකෝඩ් කරලා. දැන් මේ කරන ඒවා රෙකෝඩ් වෙනවද?
මේවා රෙකෝඩ් වෙනවා හැමදෙන්නේ. මම ඇත්තටම මේ බ්‍රයන් අපිට පාස්වර්ඩ් එකක් දුන්නා. ඒ කියන්නේ මොනවා හරි දැන් පරණ ඒවා අප්ලෝඩ් වෙලා නැති ඒවා තියෙනවා නම් මේ ආපහු ලෝඩ් කරන්න කියලා.
ඔව්.
මේ ඉතින් ඒ නිසා මේ ඔව් හැම එකක්ම මේ ආපහු ෆලෝ කරන්න පුළුවන්.
හරි. එහෙනම් අපි බලමු දැන් කී දෙනෙක් දැන් එනවද කියලා. ඒ ළමයි ආපුවාම මං පටන් ගන්න. ඉතින් ඔයගොල්ලෝ සැපසේ ඉන්නවද?
අපි හොඳට ඉන්නවා හැමදාම. හැබැයි අපේ රන්දිමාට පොඩ්ඩක් මේ පහුගිය සතිය අසනීප වෙලා මේ ගෙදර ගෙනාවා යුනිවර්සිටි එකෙන් බඩේ අමාරුවක් හැදලා. දැන් හොඳයි ටිකක්.
එයා වැක්සින් එක අරන් ඉන්නේ.
ඔව් අපි කොවිඩ් ටෙස්ට් එකක් කරා. මේ ඒ වුණාට එහෙම ප්‍රශ්නයක් නැහැ. මේ දවස්වල මේ ස්ටොමක් ෆ්ලූ එකක්.
මං මේ දැන් තුනකට වගේ ඉස්සෙල්ලා ගිහිල්ලා මගේ කෝවිඩ් බූස්ට් එකකුත් ගත්තා, මේ ෆ්ලූ ෂොට් එකකුත් ගත්තා එකම දවසේ.
ඒක හොඳයි. හාමුදුරන්ට හාමුදුරුව මේ ෆයිසර් වැක්සින් එකනේ ගත්තේ නේද?
ඔව්
ඔව් ඒක හොඳයි. හාමුදුරන්ට නියුමෝනියා වලටත් දෙනවද මේක වැක්සින් එක?
නියුමෝනියා වලට දීලා තියෙනවා දෙකක්. අර නියුමෝකෝකල් කියන එක. ඒක දෙසරේ දෙන්නේ ඊට පස්සේ දෙන්නේ. එතකොට දැන් ඔය මේ ෆ්ලූ ෂොට් එක තමයි අවුරුදු පතා ගන්නෙ.
ඔව් ඔව් ඒක හොඳයි.
දැන් ළමයි තව දෙන්නෙක් ඉන්න බව පේනවා. මේ කවුද මේ? අනයා and දසුන් අබේ කෝන්. එතකොට කෝ මොන පේන්නේ නැහැ ළමයි. අනයා දසුනා ඔයිනේ අනයා කෝ දසුන්. දැන් ඉන්නවා දසුන්, තව ඉන්නවා නදුනිත් ඉන්නවා. ඕ නදුනි. එතකොට මේ අපේ ගුණතිලක මහත්තයත් ඉන්නවා. දැන් හයක් වුණ. මේ ඇඳ ගන්න අමාරුයි වගේ වෙලාවට ඉන්න. කෑම එහෙම කාලා ඉතින් ටිකක් බඩ පිරලා ඇති. ඉතින් ඒ නිසා තවත් උන්න දෙතුන් දෙනෙක්කෝ ඔය කට්ටිය නෑ. දැන් මේ ඔන්න මේ විදත් නම් එන්නේ නැහැ කියලා දැන් කිව්වා අය. මේ තුසාර
ස්වාමින්වහන්ස මේ නලින්තයි ප්‍රවිත්තයි දෙදිත්තයි කතා කරන්නම්ම.
හොඳයි.
මේ ප්‍රවිත් ජොයින්ට් Naduni, would you like to introduce yourself to Hamdru because this is your first time today?
I am Naduni.
Oh, Naduni, I can see your picture, your photo.
I have my camera on.
But your name, this is Naduni. Okay. So now we have 9. And... And who else? I introduced this program to another boy who is 14 years old. He came here yesterday, but yesterday they were driving to New York and then stayed last night in Hagerstown, and this morning they started. Perhaps they might be tired, but next week perhaps he might join. Yeah. So you recruit more and more individuals. Kome Mahesh Gedu and Annie. Mahesh Gedu, New York, Katini. Okay, let me begin. Good afternoon, everybody. We started talking on the Noble Eightfold Path. I believe you all know the Noble Eightfold Path. Let me remind you once again, very quickly. Right understanding, right thought, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right mindfulness, and right concentration. These are the Noble Eightfold Path. It is called noble because it brings us to noble state. Noble state is not an ordinary state. However, as ordinary people, we must begin the practice. When we practice, when we keep practicing, 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 this practice eventually makes us noble. We will graduate slowly and slowly to noble state. The noblest state is the total liberation from suffering. As long as we are caught up in stress, fear, tension, suffering, and so forth, we are not free from them, and it is difficult for us to have the title noble. So remember, this practice is not simple one, very important one. Therefore, it is called noble truth, Eightfold Path. Sometimes people ask, since this is a middle path, some people ask, is there any upper middle path, like in upper middle class in the society? Yes, I say yes, there is upper middle path. The upper middle path has different name. That name is supramundane noble eightfold path. Supramundane, not mundane, but supramundane noble eightfold path. Mundane noble eightfold path begins with believing in karma and rebirth. Supramundane noble eightfold path begins with impermanence, unsatisfactoriness, and selflessness. Impermanence, unsatisfactoriness, and selflessness. We will explain these things in detail later on. Today, we are on the seventh step. Last week, I spoke on the seventh step. The seventh step is right mindfulness. Right mindfulness. Mindfulness is a very, very important. Most of the practice based on mindfulness. mindfulness is so popular. These days, millions of people practice mindfulness. There are under various names, people practice mindfulness. Now, sometimes people think that we have to sit in one place in very comfortable posture in a quiet place to practice mindfulness. Friends, if you have such a place and practice meditation, you might gain concentration. But to gain mindfulness, you can use everything that you use in your life. Sitting, standing, walking, lying down, eating, drinking, writing, listening, talking, even using restrooms, in any activity, we can practice mindfulness. Mindfulness is not anything sacred, not sacred. Mindfulness is not something holy. But if we practice mindfulness, eventually we will become holy and clean and pure. So there are five purposes of practicing mindfulness. Five. Number one, the purification of our minds. Friends, all our problems, all our suffering, all our difficulties arise from impure state of mind. When the mind is not pure, with that state of mind, if we speak and think and act, then the result will follow us like the cart that follows the hoofs of the ox that pulls the cart. I think I gave you this simile, this to explain how important the purification of mind is. We have to clean up our mind. That is one, number one purpose. How to clean it? How to clean it? You can, because mind can be polluted, not only in sitting, perhaps in sitting, the chances of making the mind polluted would be less. The more chances are there for mind to get polluted when we are talking, walking, sitting, lying down, and engaged in activities. And therefore, in all these activities, we must practice mindfulness. What is this mindfulness that we are supposed to practice all the time? I give you a few examples. Now you are sitting and listening to this talk. While listening to this, sometimes you remember something that brings, that makes you upset. You remember something that makes you angry. You remember something that makes you very frustrated. At that very moment, you must look at your mind, because it happened in the mind. Incident happened sometimes yesterday, day before, sometimes a month or year ago. But you remember it right now. When you remember it right now, anger can arise. That very instant, you should be able to get rid of that anger. So, what the mindfulness does, mindfulness is very much like using a cane. You have a cane and you lead a buffalo or cow through a cornfield. The path is very narrow. Both sides are corn, very lushy, attractive, green. This horse or buffalo wants to eat that corn. If you let him eat, the cornfield owner will punish you, sue you. And therefore, we have to control your horse or buffalo or cow that you lead on that little narrow path. So the horse or the buffalo will look at the right side to eat corn. With the cane, you tap and bring horse's mouth, face to the road. And then little by this horse will turn his head to the left to eat corn. Then again you tap with the cane. Then horse will return to his straight position. Similarly, when we go wrong, when something appears in our mind that is hurting, that is harmful, that makes you unhappy, at that very moment, you must remember not to let that grow in your mind. At that very moment, you must shun it. You must nip in the bud. This is a very good term, nip in the bud. Don't let it grow in your mind. Whenever another state arises that hurts you, makes your mind polluted, you feel pain, and immediately you remove it. For instance, jealousy. Jealousy can arise in our mind. At that very moment, we use mindfulness to get rid of that. Jealousy can arise in the house, on the bus, in the classroom, when you are sitting, standing, walking, lying down, even you are eating. Jealousy can arise. At that very moment, you become mindful. Remind yourself, this is not beneficial. This is harmful. And therefore, I must get rid of it. This is called wise reflection. Wise reflection. A Pali word is very beautiful. Pali word has more profound or deep, rich meaning. Pali word is yoniso manasikara. Yoniso manasikara means noticing something from the very root. Yoni means the beginning, root. So from the root of its rising, we must notice. There are six roots we know. What are the six roots? We learn these six roots on our first Dhamma talk on right mindfulness. What are the six roots? In unwholesome, on unwholesome side, we have greed, hatred, and delusion. These are three unwholesome roots. On the wholesome side, there are three. They are non-greed, non-hatred, non-delusion. So, when especially non-greed, non-hatred, non-delusion doesn't bother us, they don't make life unhappy. they don't bring suffering. But unwholesome roots, greed, hatred, and delusion, definitely brings suffering. And therefore, we have to nip them in the bud. The very moment they arise, we must let it go. We don't sustain them, nourish them, put more fuel into them to grow. We must remove them. That is your mindfulness training. Mindfulness training. You don't have your parents behind you, nor your teachers, no religious leader behind you. You are the master. You are the owner of what you do. And you are 100% responsible for your own thoughts, words, and deeds. When we have taken such a responsibility, we always maintain mindfulness. It is also called in Pali sati. Sati means memory. You remember to do correct things to make you happy. We all know that we want to be happy. And we always want to do things that makes us happy. But when we don't have mindfulness, in the name of good, we do wrong things, bad things, and make ourselves unhappy. Expecting happiness, we do unhappy. We do things that brings us unhappiness because of our unmindfulness. When we are mindful, and if we expect to be happy, we do things that makes us happy. So you get what you sow. What you sow, you will reap. If you sow bitter seed, you reap bitter results. And therefore, whenever the mental state arises in our mind, at that very moment, we take care of it. All these arise in the mind, not because of somebody outside, not because of somebody to do something to you, but this happens only in your own mind. So the Buddha said, all the enemies, suppose you have 100 enemies, what all these enemies do to you is much less than the polluted mind can do to you. The polluted mind, corrupted mind, deluded mind, mind with anger and so forth, can hurt you more than all the enemies in the world. Because enemies are coming from outside, but mind is within you. So it is very easy for the mind to hurt you. If you know the hurting is bringing or caused by anger, we must consider anger is our enemy, not our friend. So we must let go of this anger. We all know, I use anger as an example because this is more common mental state that people experience. There are many others, but this one I mention as an example. When anger rises in our mind, if we let it grow, what happens? Our beautiful faces become ugly faces. Ugly faces. and our eyes become red. Our words become unclear. And our thinking will become unclear. When anger is there, all this turn into your unwholesome experience. And also, one who gets angry very often may grow very quickly, grow old. We all grow old, but the one who gets angry more often gets older much quickly. And therefore, for our good health, good appearance, good state of mind, we have to control our mind. Controlling means not suppressing, but looking at them at the very root, and immediately let it go. Don't leave anything for tomorrow. So suppose you have an argument with somebody, and anger arises, and at that very moment you become mindful and let it go. Don't keep an appendix for tomorrow. That is, don't keep a little bit for tomorrow. When tomorrow you get up, no anger at all in your mind. And you will be very fresh, very beautiful, very healthy, very happy. So, mindfulness, therefore, is the mental state that can cleanse our mind, purify our mind. That is number one purpose, purification of mind. The second purpose, to overcome our sorrow and lamentation. How we overcome sorrow and lamentation by practicing mindfulness? We see things exactly as they are. When we see things exactly as they are, when anything happens to us, losing our friends, losing our jobs, losing our marks, losing our competition, and so forth, we learn to accept them as the nature of our existence. And these are called loka dhamma in Pali, loka dhamma. The worldly condition, worldly states. What are the worldly states? Gain and loss. Insult and fame and defame. Then happiness and unhappiness. And blame and praise. Blame and praise. These eight are called worldly states. What are they? Labha, alabha, gain and loss. Ninda, prasansa, praise and blame. And then yasa, ayasa, fame and defame. Sukha, dukkha, happiness and unhappiness. Happiness and suffering. These are the eight. When these things happen, the mindful person will not be shaken by them. He would not be upset. He would not be depressed. He would not be disappointed. You all remember Mangala Sutta? Mangala Sutta, last one is Puttasya Loka Dhammehi. When touched by the worldly states, the mind will not be shaken. Chittangasana Kampati. mind will not be shaken. Asokan virajan, that person will be free from sorrow and clinging and be very peaceful. Kema. Kema is calm, peaceful mental state. So when we practice mindfulness, we always can maintain this state of mind, and therefore we can live very healthy and happy life. So Buddha said, it is better practicing mindfulness even for a second rather than living 100 years without mindfulness. Living one day with mindfulness is better than living 100 years without mindfulness. Why? The person feels always calm, relaxed, peaceful, and happy. And therefore, that is the second purpose of practicing mindfulness. The third purpose is overcoming suffering and grief. Suffering and grief. You know, we all can have pain. All, even enlightened persons had pain, but they did not have suffering. Why they practice mindfulness? I tell you another very beautiful simile that Buddha used to make this idea very clear, to illustrate it more clearly. Suppose you have a frying pan put on the stove, and this frying pan is being heated. It is being heated and very, very hot. It has been on the stove all day long. Just imagine how hot that pan is. Then you put a couple of drops of water into the pan. As soon as the water hits the pan, it would be evaporated, disappeared. Similarly, when we maintain mindfulness all the time, any negative state arises in the mind, it completely disappears, wipes out. You will not see the sign of it after that, completely clean and pure. Then, the fourth purpose of practicing mindfulness is to put ourselves on the track of liberation. When you run on a marathon, there are 3-4 lines. And if you go offline, you perhaps meet with an accident, or you may lose your game, your marathon. You have to stay on your lane. Similarly, when we are unmindful, we go off the road. Remember, when you drive, if you go off your lane, all of a sudden another vehicle come and hit you from behind. Or if it is two-lane road, another vehicle come in front of you, there will be head-on collision. And therefore, you have to be on your track. Similarly, mindfulness put you on the track to attain your goal of peace and happiness. That is the fourth purpose. That means putting you on the track. The last or fifth purpose is attaining Nibbana. Attaining Nibbana. So, these are the five purposes of practicing mindfulness. So, keeping this in mind, we try to practice mindfulness. In the Noble Eightfold Path, mindfulness, effort, and understanding, these three are called cardinal factors, main factors. What are the main factors? Mindfulness, effort, and understanding. We must understand first and then make effort to be mindful. When these three combine, we make our life happy and be successful in whatever we are doing. Now, friends, I said I would talk only half an hour, but today I spoke almost 35 minutes. Now you have 25 minutes. Since you don't ask me too many questions, I give you less time for asking questions. Now it is time for you to ask me questions. And I continue on this topic, mindfulness. Mind you, not today because you will get tired of listening to mindfulness. And question. Anyone? Young or adults?
Hamdruni, I want to ask you for a small clarification on points 2 and 3. 2 was to overcome sorrow and lamentation. 3 was to overcome suffering and grief. I know there are fine differences between these two, but still I would like to ask you to explain particularly how mindfulness applied in these two situations differ.
Okay. Sorrow, lamentation, pain and grief. Sorrow and lamentation. Sorrow arises when you lose something or somebody. Separation from somebody or by death or moving away from you. Sorrow can arise. Why sorrow arises? Because you have attachment to that person. Attachment to that person. When you are attached to that person, then definitely you will have sorrow. And grief arises when somebody passes away. That is a very common thing. Remembering that person's qualities and more, it is more psychologically affect you because psychologically, we know we are attached to that person. Some people think they grieve for losing someone. It is not the losing someone, disappearing someone from our sight, not having chance to associate anymore, but the attachment to that person, that image, that memory. We have so much attachment to that memory. And even though the person is passed away, reborn and disappeared, the memory keeps lingering in our mind. And therefore, sometimes people have to have counseling to get rid of their grief because they don't know how to handle it. Why? Because their attachment to that person is so great, much deeper than sorrow. Grief and lamentation is when you cry, shedding tears. The grief can stay without shedding tears all your life. But when the emotion is fresh, you can shed tears. So that's the difference. And then pain, of course, is much shorter lived. Pain arises and then disappear within few minutes or few hours. And therefore, these are the degrees of various states of suffering. So when we are mindful, we know only one, we practice only one thing. What do we practice? Everything is impermanent. My body, my feelings, my perceptions, my thought, all are impermanent. These thoughts, these memories of that person is impermanent. You will see the memory slowly fading away over a period of time. That is very natural. So, when we are practicing mindfulness, we can shorten the period of sorrow, lamentation, grief, and despair. We can shorten it. If the mindfulness is very, very powerful, then none of them will arise at all. Great disciples of the Buddha, like arahants, enlightened ones, when they lose their own fellow monks, fellow nuns, their parents and so forth, they did not have grief, sorrow, lamentation and so forth. Why? Because they knew that all these conditioned things, all sankharas are impermanent. Once we understood sankharas are impermanent, I will talk about it later some other time. What sort of sankharas that helps us to liberate ourselves? But in general, we know all conditioned things. Conditioned things means things that have come into existence through causes and conditions are called sankhara. They all are impermanent. They all are unsatisfactory. And they all are without self. When we develop, all these can be developed through the practice of mindfulness. Nothing else. No matter how much psychiatric treatment one gets, I'm not running down psychiatric treatment, but that kind of treatment will not make you totally free from sorrow and lamentation. Temporarily you can be cured, but not permanently. When we practice mindfulness, we can permanently eliminate these mental states through the practice of mindfulness. Okay? I think I must give chance to others also to ask questions.
Panteji, I have a question.
Yeah.
If there's a moment where you need utmost concentration for about 10 minutes or so, so say you're in a championship match and it's you versus another person and you need to be focused the whole time, would you say doing mindfulness around 5 to 10 minutes a day for a long time would be useful in this?
So when you are concentrating, you remember somebody?
No, when you're concentrating for about 10 minutes or so, and you're in a match or something and you need to have utmost concentration, would you say doing meditation for 10 minutes is useful every day?
Okay. Pravit, even 10 minutes concentration is very good without having any concentration. 10 minutes concentration. But mindfulness is even more important than concentration. If the benefit you gain from 10 minutes concentration, more benefit than that, you can get 1 minute mindfulness practice. In other words, mindfulness practice is more important than 10 minutes concentration, because concentration is good. We need concentration. Only when concentration is combined with mindfulness is most important. Concentration also is very important because you overcome your hindrances, 5 hindrances, to gain concentration. 10 minutes concentration is very shallow. So I would say even 10 minutes concentration is very, very good. We keep doing it. I just want to encourage you to gain concentration even for 10 minutes. But at the same time, try to be mindful. You don't need much concentration to be mindful. You just pay attention to your own mental state to notice what is going on in the mind without judging, without making any partial bias decisions. You just impartially pay attention to your mind even for 10 minutes. You can see what is happening in the mind. And if any negative mental state arises, you have to take care of it then and there, right away. And that way we train the mind to clean the mind from all kind of mental impurities. Okay? Good question. And anybody else has any other question?
Thank you, Bhante.
You are welcome.
So just to reiterate, you said to be like, can you give a shorter explanation of that? What you said, so like, it's not always about being concentrated, it's about being mindful.
Yeah.
Okay, so, but it's good to still practice it, right? As it can help if you need it later on.
Yeah, surely, surely.
Thank you, Bhante.
You're welcome.
Bhante, I have a question.
Yeah.
Does right mindfulness override, does it kind
of... Is it Nalit?
Yeah, it's Nalit.
Could you speak up a little louder?
Does right mindfulness, if you're applying right mindfulness, can it help you forget about the consequences of your past? Like, let's say you do a bad action. Can not focusing on that make, like... hard to describe, but like, can right mindfulness not give you a consequence of your past, or like, can it lessen its effect on you?
I didn't really bring your mouse close to your speaker and increase your volume.
Can right mindfulness?
I can understand that part. Can right mindfulness, and then? your computer or the speaker may have some problem. If you increase the volume, I can increase the volume in my computer.
Bantesh, I just sent it in the chat.
Okay. Now you can speak?
Yes, can you hear me?
Now I can hear you, yeah.
Okay. How can you use right mindfulness to help you get through a tough consequence? How can you use it to lessen a consequence?
To lessen the consequences?
Yes.
Yeah, that's true. That's good. When mindfulness, when you practice mindfulness, it shows the danger of some unmindful thoughts, words, and deeds. And then, if you keep practicing mindfulness again and again, the frequency of committing that unmindful thought, word, deed will be not very quick. So the period between committing it and not committing will be wider. In other words, if you do something unmindfully 4 times in 10 minutes, if you be mindful, your period of committing something, time of committing something would be in is long, and instead of 3 times, you may commit it to 2 times. And if you are more mindful, you may commit only 1 time. If you still practice mindfulness even more, you will not commit that unwholesome things at all. Just remember, this kind of illustration might help you to reduce the effect of unmindfulness when you practice, reduce the effect of your unwholesome action when you practice mindfulness. You understood?
Yes, Pante, thank you. And I have a follow-up question to that.
Okay.
How can you train right mindfulness to make it just something you don't have to think about, but something you apply?
I think, Nelly, that's a good question also. When you repeat something again and again and again and again, it becomes a habit. So habitually, it comes to you very quickly. As soon as something, that is what is called yoniso manasikara, mindful reflection, no, wise attention. Your attention immediately goes to that particular thought, because all these things happen in the thought, in our mind. When we train the mind to be mindful, it become make it as a habit. And when unwholesome things arises, this very powerful habitual training will immediately nip it in the bud. So that's how you make it strong and habit and make it more powerful. And there are many things to say. Buddha said that the unmindfulness in Pali, in order to to save time, I avoid using Pali. Unmindfulness is the path to death. Mindfulness is path to deathlessness. The mindful does not die. The unmindful is dead already. Very beautiful statement. Appamado amata padang, pamado machuno padang. appamatta na miyanti ye pamatta yathamata. Appamado amata padam. The mindfulness is the path to deathlessness. Unmindfulness is the path to death, means mara, means unwholesome things. All unwholesome things are called mara, mara, evil one. So unmindfulness is the path to mara, evil ones. Therefore, the mindfulness does not die. Mean mindful person does not fall into the trap of unwholesome evil state called mara. He does not fall into mara's trap. But the unmindful is dead already. He is trapped in the mara's trap. And therefore, when we practice mindfulness, it becomes habit, and habitually we abstain from committing some unwholesome things. Nelit, it doesn't happen very quickly. Surely everything grows very slowly. Just like when you learn how to walk and talk and write and so on, things happen very slowly. And we can accelerate the speed if you do it more often. Okay? Any other question? Okay. Danim time and tide don't wait no man. Or time and tide wait no man. Time is running. Okay. Okay.
Swamin Mahansir.
Oh.
Tushara and I are planning, right from the beginning of this series, we were planning to have organized a small magazine based on the writings by children based on this series of Dhamma talks.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I just sent the email addresses for Tushara and mine to the chat. So just wanted to tell the children that if they would like to start their write-ups, if they have not done so, to please email us.
So you ask your children to email you?
Yes, sir, Swamin Mahasa.
Okay. So
many of them have already started, like Pravit, Nelith, and Troy, but we would really like to have other children write them. And mm-hmm. also, if they are interested, we have written up basic summaries of the talks you have made, and we can share with them too.
That's very good. If any child... I come across, and if interested, I ask that person to send you his email. That person necessarily doesn't have to be in attending our Zoom talks, but the person outside this circle can write to you.
Definitely, yes, sir.
Yeah. And then you can share it with them. And also, Mr. Gunatilaka,
yes, sir.
I Originally, I planned to give only 10 talks or 8 talks, and I can make it. Now it is almost 10 talks, including the last one. But I like to continue this theme,
yes,
of giving talks to children every Sunday as long as I can, and as long as I'm healthy, till December.
Yes.
And December, I take a break for my 3 months self-seclusion and start again in March next year. And they can collect first volume this year and start second volume next year and so forth, volume after volumes.
Yes, that would be wonderful. That would
be wonderful. Yeah. If I have any other time, I'm busy with various things here. If I have any more time, I let one of you know, and then you get children ready for that, and then we continue. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
All right. Then I want to close this session.
Thank you, Bante.
And thank you very much. Yeah. And thank you all for participating. And please, adults, try to encourage your children. Don't push them. Just let them know the benefit of this practice, benefit of these talks. And I want to tell you all, remember Oya, little creek. There is no bridge. You put, make a little edanda. Put little log to walk across the creek. But this edanda, this log, may not be very steady. When you walk, perhaps you might fall into the water. Therefore, you decide to build a handrail so that you can hold on to the handrail and walk steadily. Similarly, our life is like that edanda. Religion is like that handrail. If we don't have handrail, we may fall into that water that is suffering. So remember this simile. And therefore, we must help children to walk on this edanda without falling into the river or creek, and give them the handrail. That is what I'm trying to do. Give them the handrail. Okay? All right. Thank you.
Sad.
Thank you, Bante. See you next week.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sad.
Bye. See you at the temple. Bye.
Sad.